least until he's dead. Long live the king, till we chop off his head. Long live the king, till the guillotine is through. Long live the king, as he bids his head adieu. Here's to the king, the ill-begotten, thoroughly rotten, cotton-picking king.
Boom, chick, boom, boom. Boom, chick, boom, boom.
Mourn for the king, with sniffles and a sob. Pity the king, for he has lost his job. Poor little king, this is his final day. He'll get the axe, but he'll get no severance pay. Here's to the king. Now the time has come to let old gravity do her thing.
Boom, chick, boom, boom. Boom, chick, boom, boom. Boom, chick, boom, boom.
He is the one who took our daily bread. He is the one who's paying with his head. He is the one who now receives his due. He is the one, but soon he'll be the two. Here's to the king, Louis, 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 Louis. Here's to the king. Simon says to Louis, says, "Fooey on the king." Long live the king! Long live the king! Long live the king! Not.
Schubert was probably the greatest writer of German art songs, Lieder, especially songs about losing. He wrote songs about losing your love, losing your faith. And this is a genre called Lost Lieder. A lot of individual songs by Schubert are regarded as folk songs in German-speaking countries. Everybody knows them, like An die Nachtigall, To the Nightingale, and of course Gretchen am Spinnrad, Gretchen at the Spinning Wheel, about a friend of his who liked to play roulette. Schubert set most of the Romantic poets. He set Goethe, who most people regard as the greatest German poet. Although Wagner disliked Goethe so much, he wrote an opera called Goethe Dämmerung. In English, that's that darn Goethe. He also set Schiller. Now, Schiller had a girlfriend named Freude. And it's interesting that the English word for Freude is joy, and joy is also a girl's name. An interesting coincidence, at least a little interesting. Anyway, Freude helped Schiller a lot. She helped him meet influential people, and she lent him money. She lent him a lot of money when he was in a financial bind, and he later wrote a long poem about how much he owed to joy. Thank you. I'm glad to see the forces of enlightenment winning out. Now, those of you who have read Mozart's letters, how many have read the complete letters of Mozart? Oh, yeah, right. But if you read them, you know that his letters were quite scatological. He wrote things that you couldn't print in a family newspaper. And I've always felt it sort of interesting. I think that most American off-color humor tends to be sexual, but 18th century German off-color humor was sort of scatological. So perhaps it's no surprise that when P.D.Q. Bach decided to write some art songs, he turned to the most anally oriented of all the Romantic poets, Heinrich Heine. Now, Heinrich Heine wrote in a sort of a dialect, a now obsolete dialect, a sort of halfway between German, Deutsche, and English. The dialect is called Deutsch. And the interesting thing about Deutsch is that it's so close to English that I think you'll be able to follow along the songs without a translation printed in the program, which is just as well since the lights are off anyway. Of course, there are a lot of these dialects and different kinds of in-between languages that have contributed to the American English. And like Yiddish, for instance, the older folks may remember, "Bei mir bist du schön," to me, you're beautiful, during the 40s there. And I just want to mention that du, because it happens a lot in the songs, du is the familiar form of you. Well, it's familiar if you know German. If you don't know German, it's not so familiar. But the four songs, the first one is called Das Kleines Birdie, which means the little Vöglein. And the second song is called Der Cowboy König, the Cowboy King. Now, Westerns have always been very popular in Germany, right back to the 18th century. I've always loved High Noon and Shane and Red River and everything. Now, unlike Schubert's Der Ölkönig, which means the oil baron, PDQ's song is a Lobgesang, which means a song about the lower part of the ear. The third song is Gretchen am Spincycle. It's about the relationship between God and a young maiden doing her laundry. And then finally we have the last song, Es war ein dark und stormy night. And the German romantics, were just obsessed with death. Two of the most famous Schubert songs are Death and the Maiden and The Young Man and Death. Richard Strauss wrote Tod und Verklärung, Death and Transfiguration. Not to be confused with Todd Verklärung, who's a janitor at my high school, where my kids go. And PDQ's song, Es war ein dark und stormy night, falls into this category and never gets up again. Our soloist is a wonderful tenor named David Dusing. He has a beautiful voice, and he's particularly good in the German repertoire because he has an umlaut in his name. Right over the U there. It's a genetic thing. And of course, an umlaut is really just a colon that got drunk and fell over. So now I'm very glad to present the very first performance in Baltimore County of the four next to last songs, Sickly Number Omega Minus One. Thank you.
Ein Loser, then he flipped. greatest by far. He came last night for dinner, und very nice as far. should say, I love you. Der next day, der sunset, you ridest off into. Your kind wife und children can put you on ein leash. Dein saddle ist dein pillow und du eatst keine quiche.
Und she sits
she sits like ein bump auf ein log, und she cries, lieber Gott, will my soul never be on fire? Und Gott just says, your laundry's ready for der dryer. Es war ein dark und stormy Nacht, oh ja, es really war. Und ich der Musik strommen auf mein brand new guitar. Und ich der Musik strommen auf mein brand new pedal steel guitar. Und suddenlich bei mir ich sah ein strange und ghostlich Form, ein Knight in shining armor mit ein codpiece enorm, ein Knight in shining armor mit ein codpiece, we're talking enorm. Of him, you look so very odd. Mein last name ist Verklärung, aber mein friends call me Todd. Thy last name ist Verklärung, aber mein friends usually call me Todd. Ich know, said ich, just who you are, most dreaded of all men. Aber if you think I'm going mit you, Buster, think again. Der time ist come, der jig ist up, he said zu mir, alas. Dein goose is cooked, believe me, pal, dein keister ist grass. Dein goose is cooked, believe me, pal, dein keister, I love my work, ist grass. Die Welt ist very large, said ich, mit many folks darin. So how can you keep track of every measly little sin? He answered mit ein grin. Ja, every schwer word, every curse, und every Freudenschlip, erst alles ist recorded by mein aide, Linda Tripp. Es alles ist recorded by mine aide, die trusty Linda Tripp. Und suddenly der Knight war gone, he left mitout ein peep. Und ich war in ein meadow surrounded by sheep. Und also horses, pigs und cows were grazing auf der green. Ich had to watch my step, if you know what I mean. Und das war, wenn zu mir ist come ein very heavy thought. Ein very heavy thought. Ja, das war, wenn ich realized, Das ich had, das ich had, der Farm gebaut.
Thanks a lot. The string quartet is so central to late 18th century music that P.D.Q. Bach could no more ignore it than he could master it. I figured he must have sullied the medium, but for years I could never come across the manuscript for a string quartet. Recently, however, I have found the manuscript for this rather large string quartet called The Moose. It's an interesting subtitle, The Moose. The moose used to be a general term for all bovine animals. Actually, the word moose is the plural of moo. You know, yeah, as in you and use, you know? But it is... It has come to mean just the largest of the species, animals that the males of which have such beautiful antlers that make them so magnificent and majestic that people just can't restrain themselves from shooting them. Well, I'm always impressed in Mozart and Haydn how hard the first violin parts often are, how high they go. They go way, way up there. But the first movement, not only the first violin, but all the parts go incredibly high. I mean, they go higher than human hearing can handle. And as a matter of fact, they go the highest that any quartet players have ever been forced to go without oxygen. Which is why the tempo indication is allegro ma non troppo sphere. The second movement is marked largo alla Fargo because one section sounds like a tree shredder. At one point, the cello part indicates the use of a tasso stirafomoso. And I think indeed that this is the very first quartet in the history of the quartet that requires the use of a plastic styrofoam cup. Also in this movement, P.D.Q. magically brings back the previous movement, just like Beethoven did in the Fifth Symphony. Or maybe he just misnumbered the pages. The third movement, Menuetto No Sweato, features the snap pizzicato, usually associated with Bartok. And the word snap here comes not from the sound it makes, it comes from schnapps, which is what P.D.Q. liked to drink while writing. Now the last movement starts out grave e molto deepo. And here we have to talk about P.D.Q. Bach's plagiarism. What Beethoven said about P.D.Q. Bach, they did know each other, and what Beethoven said about P.D.Q. Bach is, wenn man seine eigene Kompositionen den P.D.Q. Bach verspielt, ist es als ein Mann ein Dieb bitten würde, ein paar Minuten den Koffer zu behüten. It's funny. I suppose you want to hear it in English. In English, it's playing one of your own compositions to P.D.Q. Bach is like asking a thief to look after your suitcase for a few minutes. It's better in German, isn't it? Like Beethoven's last quartet, this piece is in F major. And there's a very interesting thing about the last movement of Beethoven's quartet. The last movement of his last quartet has a little sort of motto. It's a little bit of one measure of music that's not part of the piece itself. Music with words under it. And the words are Der schwer gefasste Entschluss. The English for that is the very tricky question. The music with the words under it is Muss es sein, which means, is it a moose? And then finally comes the answer, es muss sein, yes, it's a moose. Several sections start out exactly like the Beethoven, but then they get farther and farther away, and this is a perfect illustration of the thing that has been said about P.D.Q. Bach, which is that the most original places in his music occur where what he couldn't remember how what he was stealing from went. So here is the quartet in F major, subtitled The Moose, Schickele number Y2K, performed by the Armadillo Quartet, who flew in here from California just to play this piece for you. Here they are.
Ow! Session. Get your books out. Please. Yeah, when? Next week. Oh, wow. Next week. 22nd? 7 o'clock. It's a 7 o'clock thing.
I have a church job.
So, listen, this thing is a session. You got to get out of that church job.
You know how that important is? I don't know if I can get out of it.
No, you have to get out of it. You're okay? Okay. No, we can do it. Yeah, okay. No, it's great. Thank you. No, thank you so much. Love your word. Goodbye.
Okay, let's start at F.
Sorry.
Steve went to hello operator. Please give me number 9. And if you're just in the kingdom, I'll say I'm every kind of paper river. There is a piece of glass. And if you dare to step on it, I'll shut it up. You're asking no more questions. I'll tell you no more lies. The waves are in the bathroom. All pulling down the flies are in the country. The bees are in the pot. My boys and girls are eating in the
McKinley's 80 now, Hetty McKinley, oh wow. Aye, 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 oh me, oh my, my, oh me, oh my.
Yes, Hetty McKinley's 80 now, Hetty McKinley, oh wow.
Hetty McKinley's 80 now, Hetty McKinley,
oh me, oh my.
Hetty McKinley's 80 now, Hetty McKinley, oh wow.
Thank you. I just love writing rounds and party pieces. It's one of the many things I have in common with Mozart. Now, many of my rounds are written for a birthday or something, as in that one, but sometimes they're just the product of too much time on my hands and a diseased mind. This next one, I got to thinking about Dandy, the 19th century French composer, D'INDY, Dandy. And then I started thinking about how dindon was the French word for turkey. But dindon is also ding-dong, as in sonne le matina, dindon, dindon, dindon. I don't know what it is about the French language. It's almost as if the words were afraid to come out the mouth because they might get bitten, so they come out the nose instead. Anyway, this is a little round about Dandy's turkey. The words are ding-dong, ding-dong, the turkey of Dandy. Thus I say thus, the turkey of Vincent Dandy. Dindon, dindon, c'est le dindon de dandy, dis-je donc et donc je dis, le dindon de Vincent Dandy.
Dindon, dindon, c'est le dindon de dandy, dis-je donc et donc je dis, le dindon de Vincent Dandy. Dis-je donc et donc je dis, le dindon de Vincent Dandy.
Well, a lot of people have said that I actually made PDQ up, and that's a scurrilous lie, a shameless canard. Just because there's no direct evidence of something doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Like WMD, for instance. And so sometimes you just have to take things on faith, like the Tooth Fairy and the Easter Bunny and Dick Cheney. And anyway, PDQ Box certainly did exist, as far as I'm concerned. And and he also liked to write rounds. The first one is on an old poem, a very old poem. It goes, the mule he has two legs behind and two he has before. We stand behind before we find what the two behind before. Very old poem. I think it comes from the Iliad.
The mule, he has two legs behind and two he has before. We stand behind before we find what the two behind before.
The mule, he has two legs behind and two he has before. We stand behind before we find what the two behind before.
The mule, he has two legs behind and two he has before. We stand behind before we find what the two behind before.
The mule, he has two legs behind and two he has before. We stand behind before we find what the two behind before.
Thank you. And the last one of PDQ's rounds that we're going to sing is about an instrument called the serpent. It is now pretty much obsolete, which is the best thing you can say about it.
Oh, serpent, how full of surprises art thou! Thou look'st like a snake, yet sound'st like a cow. And oh, when it comes, when it comes, when it comes to the people who play thee, I always have found they don't know their asp from a hole in the ground.
Oh, serpent, how full of surprises art thou! Thou look'st like a snake, yet sound'st like a cow.
And oh, serpent, oh, how full of surprises art thou!
When it
thou
comes,
look'st like a snake,
when
yet sounds like a cow.
To the people who play the surprises art have found thou! When they don't like know their ass from a hole in the ground.
To the people who play the surprises art thou!
our love must surely be much realer than real estate and maybe even reality. Oh my, oh me. And if a tree should fall in the forest primeval where there's no one around to hear the sound, will there really be any sound? Oh my, oh me. And what about the paradox of Zeno from ancient Thrace? He said that it's impossible to go from place to place because you must proceed through half of the distance between, and then there is always half the distance left. It's a mystery. Oh my, oh me. This song's refrain is obviously oh my, oh me. And yet that's not the title of the song. The title happens to be If Love Is Real, which is really quite hard to believe, 'cause usually the title of a song is the refrain, you see. Oh my, oh me.
Now I know you're probably thinking, how about Strangers in the Night? The title is the first four words, and they only happen twice or thrice. But that's a song without a refrain, while we are singing a number whose refrain, I think we can all agree, can only be thank you. I have a terrible time remembering names. I let my kids take their name patches off when they reached puberty. But what I'm particularly concerned about is people, you know, a store that you go into often and you really like one of the clerks or something, you like to remember their name. And what I discovered a few years ago is that if I wrote a little poem about the person, then I could remember the name. Like there was a real peppy woman in the pharmacy. She was really fun to talk to, and I really wanted to remember her name, so I made up this poem. That Mamie, she's gamey, but hey, she's a cheater. I asked for Viagra, she gave me saltpeter. It's a little joke there. She didn't really give me saltpeter, right? Anyway, this next one is a deli that I used to go to every morning and get coffee in a sweet roll or something, and this really nice young woman named Cindy was behind the counter. It was just a nice way to start the day talking to her. So I wanted to remember her name, and I started out to write a little poem, but it ended up my writing the song you're about to hear, which includes every rhyme for Cindy I could think of, and then some. I did use a rhyming dictionary, and I want to tell you that the word shindy is a variation of shindig, and I did not make it up. So anyway, I used every rhyme I could think of for Cindy, and when I finished this song, I could remember her name, and then the store closed. Cindy, well, I will never call you Mindy. Or would you like to do the Lindy, Cindy, with me? Oh, yes, and Cindy, you could be driving in the Indy, but now it's getting kind of windy, so Cindy, we'll see. your beauty only skin deep. I'm in deep trouble if you won't say you'll be true. Ooh, Cindy, you're like a symphony by Dindy, and I would really like to sing deliriously Cindy with you. Oh, Cindy, if I could say your name in Hindi, all India would know that I'm in love with you. Ooh, Cindy, so we go out and have a shindy. I'd suffer from a vitamin deficiency, oh Cindy, without you. Michigan, there's a town called Kindy. I can't begin describing how much I'm in love with you. Ooh, Cindy. By now I think it's getting to be pretty obvious. I'm running out of rhymes for Cindy. So Cindy, be true. Before I went to Juilliard, I went to Swarthmore College. Swarthmore College is just a little bit out of Philadelphia. My family lived in Fargo, North Dakota, which is just a little bit out of Canada. You know, you didn't bop on planes and off planes the way you do now, or at least as the way you used to do now. So I only went home twice a year for summer and Christmas. And I went by bus, by the way. No flying, no train. Went by bus. A 48-hour trip from Philadelphia to Fargo. So you have a lot of time to think. You know, about morals and values and ethics. All the things that a teenage boy thinks about. And I remember standing in the bus station at Philadelphia. I was taking a Shakespeare class. And I thought to myself, what it would be like if you took some of the famous Shakespeare speeches and set them to a more modern musical idiom. So we're going to end with five songs from Shakespeare, beginning with the famous soliloquy from Macbeth. Mañana, mañana, mañana. Creep on in this petty pace from day to day until the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesteryears have lighted fools away to dusty death. Out, 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 brief candle. Life is but a poor player who struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. 'Tis tale told by an idiot full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. To be, just a question. To die, to sleep no more. 'Tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. To die, to sleep, perchance to dream. There's the rub. Hail Macbeth, Thane of Glamis. Hail Macbeth, Thane of Cawdor. Hail Macbeth, King hereafter. Hail, hail, hail.
and filthy air.
When shall we free meet again? In thunder or in rain? When the hurly-burly's done drifting along on the blasted heath?
Oh, I wish I was a glove on that there hand. Oh, I wish I was a glove on that hand, so that I could touch that pretty little cheek, 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 so that I could touch that pretty little cheek.
Ah, me,
ah, me,
ah, me,
ah, me. Oh, my love, it is as boundless as the sea. Oh, I wish I was a glove on that there hand, so that I could touch that pretty little cheek. Oh, Romeo, oh, Romeo, where is you at? Oh, Romeo, where is you at? Cause I love you though you is a Montagu, goo, goo. Cause I love you though you is a Montagu.
What's in a name?
What's in a name?
What's in a name?
Oh, a rose if called a rat would smell the same. Oh, Romeo, Romeo, where is you at? Cause I love you though you is a Montagu.
Friends, Romans, countrymen, why don't you lend me your ears?
Yeah.
A cause to bury Caesar, not to blaze him. A cause to bury Caesar, not to praise him. A Brutus is a Brutus is a Brutus is an honorable man.
Well, he thrice refused the kingly crown. Was this ambition, I ask you now?
I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him.
I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him.
A Brutus is a Brutus is a honorable. Brutus is a Brutus is a Brutus is an honorable man.
When my son was 6 years old, he used to worry a lot about dinosaurs. And he'd watch those Japanese monster movies in the afternoon, and then he'd have nightmares at night. And so I wrote this song for him, and he says it helped a little. Listen here, Tyrannosaurus Rex. You think that you're the king? Just because you're the biggest and the meanest, well, you think that you can scare everything? Well, you may scare the brontosaurus and the fishes in the sea, but listen here, Tyrannosaurus Rex, I want to tell you that you don't scare me. It's the dinosaur dance. Listen here, Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Yes?
You think that you're so bad?
That's right.
Just because they tell you you're the meanest living creature that the world's ever had?
I am.
Well, you may scare the Diplodocus.
That's Diplodocus.
And the fishes in the sea. Listen here, Tyrannosaurus Rex, I want to tell you that you don't scare me.
I don't?
Tyrannosaurus Rex. Tyrannosaurus Rex. Tyrannosaurus Rex! Tyrannosaurus Rex! Tyrannosaurus Rex! Tyrannosaurus Rex! Tyrannosaurus Rex!
You don't scare me!